Hello and welcome back to Blacker Couch Reviews. I'm your host, Christina. We're back to discuss the finale episode of Three Body Problem, episode 8, Wall Facer, written by David Benioff and D.B. Weiss, directed by Jeremy Padawesa. I said that all types are wrong. Padawesa. That's as good as I'm going to get. This finale had some good parts, then it had a pacing issue. It certainly did not need to be 58 minutes long. It could have been cut down to 27 minutes and it would have probably been perfect. The biggest issues for me personally for this season, which we've already kind of touched on quite a few times, has been the dialogue, the humor, rather hit and miss, the casting choices. I'm just going to go out there and say that. The casting choices. As well as the pacing and some of the just kind of irrationality in the storytelling. There was always an intriguing element that wove its way, kind of like the failed mission of this project that they enacted. And I'm glad it failed. I think that was one of the better triumphs of this season, is that humanity is not out here filling itself the way it was trying to fill itself the last four episodes. And I think if they had put this episode after the events that happened in this episode, after number four, when did they reveal themselves? Oh, that was number five. Yeah, if you had put this at number five and you cut a lot of the Will shit out of it, because I don't know what the point of it was other than to play on Jen's guilt, I think we could have pulled from her childhood. The characterizations were there wasn't a lot of meat on any of them. Jen being the only exception until they decided to, well, her actions, unfortunately, made her hard to truly understand. Well, understand, if maybe not like. That would be a better way to, because I think there is a part of her that would be on Wade's side, and that's just something we ourselves are getting to learn about the character, and just because it isn't necessarily morally within our stratosphere doesn't mean it isn't a character trait. However, we do need someone that is at least likable. And until Augie, with her decisions last episode, we didn't have that. So it took a really long time to try to figure out what it wanted to be. And one may say, hey, that's, you know, it's a first season, kind of like The Acolyte. The Acolyte had its problems, had its pacing, so on and so forth. But I said the exact same thing that I'm saying with this show. I'm not sure if I would want to come back for the second season. This doesn't leave me with any anticipation for whatever weight that is. Now, if it's coming back and it's like 6 months, 6 to 8 months, well, then we may have a different scenario. And always you have the trailers or the opportunity to course correct. So I do think the opportunity is there in this show to really tighten up a lot of the, and again, this is just my opinion, though. Could be others that don't feel the exact same way. Thought Clarence was absolutely hysterical. There wasn't enough Tatiana. There wasn't enough character development. That's the word I was looking for earlier. With anyone, with the exception of Ye. And one may argue, well, it is a three season paced out arc. This one was all about how the aliens came to the planet, what precipitated that. That was fine. That was some of the best storytelling that they did. But everything in the present simply did not match that energy. And then you gave us five characters that were not the best. And this episode, we spent the majority of one of the characters we've spent the least amount with. The only thing this show has been intent on highlighting to us, the audience, about Saw is the fact that he's a pothead and a man whore.
Got the nasty in my taxi. You need a lift? You can sit between the backseat of my taxi.
No disrespect to the actor whatsoever. He's not an unattractive male. But if you are going to portray someone in this capacity, he needs to be believably in this role. Maybe culturally, there's different attractive key components. But it's not believable to me that Saw is pulling the chicks that he's pulling to the point that they would be upset that he doesn't call them by their name, even though he knows their name. Is he packing a Bruce Venture cock? Is that it? His name is Saw, the Danny D. Duran. Why is this the only thing I know, though, about Saw? I do believe in the, let me pull that up because I thought I saw it. In the character description, it said, Dr. Saul Duran, a research assistant and member of the Oxford Five. So he's someone that's supposed to be extremely educated, sophisticated, probably has a lot of ideas in his head. We got a little bit of his mindset. But where was that all seven episodes prior? The only thing they wanted us to know was how sloppy his personal life is amidst Pussy and the Pipe.
Every day, every night, all the time, every day.
I would have been more intrigued if he had started talking to people in the park about their ideas or debating anything, anything other than he has it bad for Augie but won't commit because he doesn't want to have children in the future or a family. And someone like Augie would certainly want those things in the future. And that is something that would have been interesting to know and inform us about the character, but these things are afterthoughts. Have you, audience, ever had an indignant one-night stand? Because unless you're like,
get the fuck out my house,
there is no reason for her to have come out in her towel all hostile because he's listening to the television that seems to upset you. I suggest you enjoy the hospitality of my shower and not pretend either of us were sober enough last night to get to know each other. Otherwise, you would have known that I'm an asshole. Don't turn your shame on me. And did she tell him to get her an Uber?
She belongs to the streets.
They must do it differently over there in London, because not only did he get her an Uber, he walked her there as if it was not broad daylight. Sis, did your phone not work? As a woman, I would never. If a guy is sitting there and he's just chilling, I'm chilling, he ain't said nothing rude to me, you're like, oh, You don't know what my name was. You made an assumption. So if you choose to make an ass out of yourself and me, I'm gonna let you go ahead and do that. Why is humanity so indignant at being referenced as a bug? We do not consider the bugs that we ourselves smash beneath our feet. I think I brought this up last podcast, that our ego is so big, humanity, especially the more privileged amidst thee, they seem to be the most offended. Some of us have been considered less than animals by our own species. Or inhuman by our own species. So put that in your pipe and smoke it. Saul remarks that his ancestors were in Africa 400 years ago. I wanted to say, do you know that? Did you go to ancestry.com? Just because you are black does not mean you are African. I mean, let's be real. Most of us are from Africa. But the pigmentation is not the only key element of what your ancestors were doing 400 years ago. Because you could have been Africa, or you could have been cargo in India somewhere. Or in Madagascar. Or in South America. Whichever immersive experience you doth have been dealt. Basically, one generation never imagined what the next generation or the next generation's changes would happen. And if we're talking early humanity to the modern times, yeah, that would look like science fiction. He doesn't want to waste his time on Earth freaking out about something he has absolutely no control over, which is why he's self-medicating. And he isn't about continuing his own generational trauma, which is very fair. Because it's not like in modern times, everyone's talking about the aliens. Well, I myself am still considered an alien. So maybe we are bugs. And if you haven't been through that particular experience, you would not see the irony. But he also lets her know, hey, it's fair if you are all up in your shits about it. Because she's like, well, I want to have kids and I want to do this. What part of one night stand were you not catching when it was 3 a.m. when we climbed into these sheets? She acted like they were supposed to get married and she didn't even know him very well, even though she remembered his name. Okay, you have a great memory. Especially comparatively, the experiences between his ancestors and hers are vastly different. I'm not Irish. Well, you sure as shit ain't Negro. He's a cynic, yes, but is not trying to pass off his philosophy onto anyone else. It's more like, why are you mad because I'm not feeling what you're feeling? I get this a lot, particularly about certain topics and issues where my mind is pulling from a pattern of societal human behavior that I find both fascinating and reflective, whereas other people may find it terrifying. And while I'm not negating your own emotions in regards to the matter, I'm really not, my mind has, it remains rational, you know, because I think when we let fear in, we have a tendency to become irrational. That's just the state of emotions in itself. Emotions are irrational. So, yeah, I got what he was saying. I related to what he was saying. Like, you're the one upset here that I'm not taking it more seriously, and you're just mad because you wish you had my energy right now. Then she's hit by a car so hard it left injuries incompatible with life, and my first thought was, stupid.
don't know mother.
Then they had to ruin it with, no, I'm not a complete asshole. I knew her name. I thought it would have been perfect if he found out her name when Clarence came in and said, sorry about Nora, was she a friend? I thought that would have been a better emotional beat for the character and about his indifference and starting some type of trajectory there. And it was a missed opportunity that they shat on because they didn't want to make him out to be an absolute douche. Clarence somehow never met Saul, despite the fact that he knows all the protagonists. He has to break it down to him that the woman who is responsible for contacting the aliens, yay, in the sky is now dead, and now they are coming after him since she is the only person he met with having been spied on. He has no idea what is going on, but he doesn't know how to do simple math, which once again goes back to, this is the guy. He needs to ask if they are who they are, as if they aren't the aliens that are clearly the enemy everyone's talking about when they even mention they. And that Ye was holding a cult around these aliens because your friends told you so. And one was murdered because of it. So I think you would be a little bit more on the knowledge tip about where things were unfolding, and yet he continued to be Where's Waldo? Clarence, for his part, it's like, I'm not going to give you any answers, but here are some bulletproof clothes. Autonomous cars should never be a thing. For this exact reason, nothing is hack-proof, and three autonomous cars on a road feels like a step forward in humanity that we're not prepared to take. The all-black plane, that looks sick. Him showing up on the tarmac, that also looks sick. It felt like there was a seriousness behind the show that it's been lacking thus far. At a castle in the middle of no fucking where with Wade. Saw can't figure out what could possibly be going on with aircraft carriers surrounding him.
You're so dumb. You are really dumb. For real.
I do hate when this show ruins its own kudos. Because it started taking itself seriously and then had Clarence be the only person shown anywhere on this plane with Saul. He should be surrounded, especially for the position in which he's been already selected due to information that he isn't even considering puzzling over. And they tried the humor once again with the overweight bodyguard. That's another casting decision. Like, Clarence does not, I get it. Do not weight shame. You don't know anyone's capabilities based on, fuck all that. Navy SEAL motherfuckers would not. We need the best of the best, the top of the top, and there's nothing about Clarence that convinces me otherwise. You know, the least he can do is slow down on the Haagen-Dazs. There should at least be some upper body strength. You know, even if you want to get the pudge in there, got some strong calves or something. He's offering nothing. So all this taken to the United Nations, and finally it feels as if there are, like I said, more involved people than would be, than we've been shown prior. Because we all know if aliens are here, it'll be the crazy motherfuckers we all know within the world who has three times the defense budget of between the top five countries combined, preparing, have already been preparing for this exact same scenario.
Hey,
like, where are the English motherfucking people? And I don't mean the British. We're the ones that is going to take this to a whole fucking level that, I'm sorry, I love you, but let's be real. Your police officers got billy clubs still, bruh. They have been planning planetary defense with, this is their fourth meeting. I wish we had gotten some indication of this. This would have been an easy tie-in if we, you know, had weighed against this chick who seems 10 times more competent because she actually acknowledges, hey, we're at a disadvantage. We are doing this because we owe it to our, we owe it to our who we leave the planet to do the best that we can. Everything about what she was saying was rational, made more sense, felt more human, not maniacal and egotistical and self-serving. Wade. But when she started talking about how they're being watched at all times selectively and how, you know, how we're considered bugs and pests and now we have no power, I was like, are you talking about the Santi or our own government? Because the similarities were uncanny. Then unveils the Wallfacer project. Since the Santi can't read minds, neither can we, let's get our top three randomly selected to develop strategies and plans entirely in their own mind, sharing them with no one until it is time to execute them, given blanket immunity as long as it's not fucking with international law, with all the resources they could muster, and no one is to question their decisions.
What did he say?
I cannot be the only person that is not thinking, this doesn't sound conducive. It sounds perilous. I don't know what is the alternative, but I can already see the flaws in this plan being humans be human in, okay? No one should be given absolute power. Absolute power corrupts. Absolutely. General Howe has been on the job for less than 24 hours and he's requesting shit. But for some reason, as the names are being ticked off, he still hasn't done that very basic math, our dearest Saul. Layla Eric is also someone that's chosen. People have posters of her on her wall. No, they wouldn't. Not for what she does. He was chosen due to Ye dropping a huge secret to him in a riddle that he hasn't even contemplated. Instead, just keeps asking for the next 20 minutes.
What? Bro, what are you talking about, man? Bro, I'm out, man. That nigga's tripping.
It was frustrating because you just gave this guy who can't be bothered to, I mean, maybe it's stoner brain. You know, he's been on a consistent weed diet. It started to kill those brain cells just a little bit. He's got to get those gears oiled up. Then he's definitely going to have to stop with the excessive intake. Because that was a 4-hour plane ride. That wasn't a 4-hour plane ride. I don't think it's a 4-hour plane ride to the United Nations, which is, I have no fucking clue. Yes, these are things I should know, but because I kind of feel like the United Nations are a bit of a wee bit of a joke. That's neither here nor there. Never really decided to figure out where it was located. Where's it going here? Oh, I was really upset with how long it took him to answer his own question, which is a very stupid question because he told you when you were in the room. And for some reason, you just kept thinking, well, you know, they just announced to everyone that I'm one of the wall facers. But if I refuse to do it, even though I just listened to the rules that were very clear, which is whatever they want to do, we're just going to do it, even if it doesn't make sense. We're just going to guess it's a part of their plan. This type of nonsensical thought process is exactly why his fate was sealed. I will say some of the best scenes were from the villains this episode. Because when he brought in the man that shot him, because when he went outside, he was shot. Forgot to mention that part. For a second, I thought, oh, it must have been the people that clearly want you to be part of their team that gave that order. But alas, since Clarence felt bad about failing at his job, and Wade definitely would have revealed because no one's around if he and she were on that, even though, shit, she is American. We don't share information, even with our allies. But the guy coming in saying, I'm sorry, I didn't aim for your head.
Oh, shit! Oh, shit! Oh, shit!
If you're going to question your enemy, Saw, actually question them. Seriously. Don't ask them the same. Like, you're just doing this for the aliens? Don't you understand? I am a soldier in the army for the Lord. And since we are already highly religious in America, this checks. And you are dumb if you still haven't. When he said you're funny, I was like, why am I agreeing with the sniper assassin? If I'm not a wall facer, if I refused, if I didn't do it, let me talk back to the... I think I love Kent, though. I am your day-to-day liaison. So if I refuse, what are you still doing here? I am your day-to-day liaison. And Clarence is now his bodyguard. Jen, moving on to her to link up with Saw, has the absolute worst boss. Even though at the end he was like, I have a soul. I'm going to go ahead and let you think that your friend is still alive because it's fresh and we all know what you did. Why are you trying to feed a brain is a valid question. And you aren't feeling guilty when you asked him to do it.
Ain't nobody got time for that.
She then dumps her hot ass boyfriend because she suddenly had an epiphany that she loves Will. Though he was dying for weeks, so his current death was always gonna be the outcome. Me thinks that billion-dollar gesture may have changed her mind on whether, and I don't even know if that was sincere. I don't know if her saying she loved him is sincere because she wasn't in love with someone 1 second and not in love with them the next second. I mean, it's pathetic that Will would, that he's pathetic enough to settle for this, but I will not. She thinks the Santi will recreate his body. That's her goal. Varma comes in like, did we break up or what? She doesn't want to talk about the fact that she never loved him in return, but clearly he loved her. And because he's dead now and she convinced him to pull the plug for her impossible project to get her the status, power, whatever it is, to be a part of the thing, whatever this thing is, to be in the know, to be one of the pioneers of science. She was willing to use her friend. And it wasn't even the worst thing, you know, other than it was for Wade. because he was already dying. And it was, and it needed to work. That was the big thing. It needed to not be for nothing. So I think her guilt is wrapped up in this sudden love for him, because the entire time there was no lingering or longing. He was a pal. And I think she's trying to convince herself she reciprocated his love, which is why Varma's looking at her while she eyes the rocket like, no, they didn't have Shaw. No, they didn't have Saw show up with the bullet in the bulletproof clothes like they are recyclable. Wait until Augie tells him Jen's the one that sold Will out, even though she really didn't, but she did. And it was for Wade. Oh, it wasn't even like it was her idea. And he randomly selected him. I still don't even know what the qualifications were. The rocket mission goes awry, and I kind of cackled, and Jen is devastated. So Clarence shows them some cicadas, her and Saw, to recall humanity's resilience. Even though we're still dealing with climate change and a lot of things that are happening more immediately than the aliens, we are doing absolutely nothing to attack those things. But we are pouring all of Earth's resources and now all of their scientists into this future 400-year project. So now everything that could be happening right now could potentially stall as far as when it comes to whether or not humanity will be anything worth saving if its people begin to deteriorate from the very real problems that are happening right now. I don't know why no one's thinking about this. My favorite part of this season is Wade being dragged in that freaking plane. They was fucking with him. When she showed up, first she started with like some light turbulence. A little bit of interference. Then she said, I'm sorry the staircase project failed. We would have liked to meet Mr. Downing. Shots fired. I'm going to put this out there right now. They better not find Will and recreate his body, or his brain is picked up somewhere. I will not have it. I don't know what the purpose of the character was. I think he was purposeless. And I don't need him to come back into the show. And I think he actually was the weakest actor of them all. And then she follows up with, and we hope to meet you if your hibernation technology works. Human beings are so fragile. Then through some more turbulence, like, look, I could kill you right now. I could toss this plane out of the sky. And I'm glad they brought back the time clocks. Like, I feel like Wade needed this moment because he was out here throwing his cock around like he didn't comprehend how, like, they're doing some shit that's magical. We ain't there. He takes this moment to boast of his own importance, though, because he ain't quite humbled. So, yeah, she had to up it. Auntie, like, you know what? You are part of our plan. So whatever you do, know it's for our benefit. And when we meet, we got something just for you. We will let you see what we want you to see. We gonna be in the room before you enter the room. And you gonna do what the fuck we want, because you're our bitch until the day you die. Ah!
Yes, queen.
We briefly caught up with Augie, who is living it up in Mexico, being a humanitarian, now ignoring calls from Saul. And Tatiana gets her welcome to the Santi family gift. And they are now making their own plans. They're like, okay, let me see what the worst they're going to be able to do. What are they going to come up with? It's almost like, let me. It's sad because it's like playing with someone that, like, an adult and a child, and, you know, you want to play boxing with them, and you're just like, oh, put your little dukes up, let me see, you got it. And every once in a while, they might clock you real good. They just happen to get lucky. But most of the time, you know, you're going to have that little, you know. But if you was to actually hit them back the way with your superior strength, so it's more like, Wade and his whole staircase project was, you know, this soft punch. And they're like, okay, let me show you exactly how you throw one. It was a decent finale, but it was entirely too long. It should have been cut for time. And I think that's one of the benefits of shows like The Bear, that is kind of like the benchmark of, you don't need to fall into these continuous movie and TV tropes. You can redefine the genre by doing what is needed, what is necessary per episode within the structure of, you know, maybe it's an hour. I don't need an hour every episode. And maybe another episode you do spend more time, depending on what it is that you're doing. Or maybe you just have 10 episodes that are 30 minutes long or 35. Whatever they need to be is when you need to cut it the fuck off. And I hate Dead Space. And seriously, watching Saw ask the same question over and over again was the worst thing this finale did. So yeah, we'll see if we'll be back for season 2. I did do 3 seasons of Vikings Valhalla. I ain't doing the 4th season, but Lord knows it had its own issues. And I kind of want to know what happens with the Santi. I just want to see how they fuck us up. I'm sure we'll win, because of course we do in these type of scenarios. I think if they have some different people in there, different writers, they can definitely make this far more palatable, make it far more of a tight ship, that it would be a nice, smaller but bigger type of show to watch, you know, because everything doesn't have to be the everyone mentions Game of Thrones because it's recency bias, but the biggest watch show that everyone's talking about doesn't need to be the Cooler Fridge show, just needs to be a decent one. And I would say this one slightly passing the grade, which is like a D+. It's not failing, but it sure could as a way to get to C. If you want to send feedback or you have any lingering questions, blackercouch@gmail.com. I will be following up this show with Umbrella Academy. So if you want to send feedback for that last season, blackercouch@gmail.com. Once again, you can leave a comment below. My social media will be there as well. Like, share, subscribe. Until the next time, peace, hair grease, and blacker magic.